introduced the coal industry bill, which was the biggest reforming bill miners had since nationalisation. That it reversed the policy of the Labour government of closing the uneconomic pits. It massively increased the miners' pension scheme. And I was sort of hero of the piece. The Miners magazine had as their front page great pictures of Peter Walker with the editorials praising him for his radical and important measure. I used to go and visit mines and got given miners' lamps and was probably the most popular Tory minister with the miners that there'd been ever.
I was conscious that we were not in a free situation with the employers to freely bargain with the employers, and I was conscious that the government at some stage would be forced into the battle in terms of that resolution.
So you were quite clear that the miners were, as it were, a spearhead of a battle against a stage three policy?
I was quite clear, and I made it clear in my contribution to the conference that, in fact, it would mean that we've got to face up to the realisation that this would bring the government into the picture, and therefore, when passing the resolution, we were conscious that the government would come into the picture in terms of the negotiations.
The Wilberforce settlement had recognised the special physical discomforts and dangers of the miners' life. But by 73, average earnings in the coalfields had fallen behind the national figure of £38 a week. In April, the miners had settled within stage two of the government's compulsory pay policy, but they were in no mood to knuckle down to a third stage. The architect with Ted Heath of that incomes policy had been Sir William Armstrong, then head of the civil service. He is now Lord Armstrong and chairman of the Midland Bank, but retains a vivid memory of the thinking that led eventually to an incomes policy.
The policy of the Conservative government had been, well, it had been called confrontation. I don't want to say that was the intention, but that is what it had become to be thought of. And there had been the policy that was called N-1, the idea of which was that each settlement should be a little bit lower than the previous one. None of these things had seemed to me to work. And then there was the Industrial Relations Act, which plainly wasn't working. So I felt that the government had come to a dead end and was very pleased indeed to find that the Prime Minister had already been having quiet talks with the TUC and the CBI and was wanting to move on to what Winston called jaw-jaw and not war-war.
Here you had a government and a party leader which had been elected that's utterly opposed to wage restraint. Can you say what it was that changed their mind?
Well, that is difficult because of the enigmatic quality of Ted Heath that we all know about. He didn't always explain why he wanted to do things. You could have left a bit to guess. But guessing, I think he was convinced that what had happened up to now was wrong, had failed, and a new direction had got to be found. I think the miners' strike, which was settled by the Wilberforce settlement in 1972, convinced him of that. He felt this surely is not the way to go about it. And it would be much better if only we could talk together and not have this sort of scrapping and eventually settlement imposed from somewhere else. I think that was very, very much part of it in his mind. I think also, though I may be wrong about this, that he woke up with rather a jerk to some of the things that had been happening on in one part of the ship while he was occupied in other parts. He was very much a man who gave out the jobs and left people to get on with them. And he, of course, personally was enormously concerned with getting into Europe and getting the legislation through and so on. And I think that when he discovered that in the meantime an Industrial Relations Act had been passed that didn't actually accord with his idea of how to deal with trade unions and trade union disputes, he was a little bit taken aback. And again, I think that contributed to his feeling that there must be a new direction.
Ted Heath invited Joe Gormley, president of the miners, for an informal talk in the garden of 10 Downing Street. The meeting was kept secret from the union executive and Mr. Heath's cabinet colleagues. It was but the first in what would become a series of missed and and misunderstood opportunities.
We were very concerned about the miners, although they had accepted stage two in April. In July, they had accepted or passed, endorsed a claim that went considerably further than anything that we could see was likely to fit into stage three. So we were concerned about them. And we were looking around for ways of dealing with this situation.
Why did the meeting have to take place in the garden?
Because it was the high summer and was hot, and most of Mr. Heath's meetings at that time took place in the garden.
It was allowed to be a lovely day. He might have sat in the middle of the garden, and this AMRSTONG you talk about, I didn't know him at that time. I don't get involved in the civil servant very much, but there was three of us sat at the table. And after the usual generalities, he just said to me, well, he always says, well, what's the chances this year? I said, it's going to be tough. In fact, I said, it's going to be bloody tough. I said, you know the resolution that's been carried out at conference, which I fully support. I said, you know that resolution, and any policy that you're talking about must give us a chance to reach those objectives. So he said, oh, well, things will be difficult. And I said, well, I'm afraid that's it, difficult. Well, then I said, but of course, it's not the only thing we have before us, a claim in wages before the board. We shall have a claim for an increase in unsociable hours payments, for example. And I'll never forget them both turning around one to the other and saying, we'd never thought of that. We'd never thought of this at all. I said, well, these are things for you to think about.
Joe Gormley left that garden gathering an optimistic man. He was convinced that the government would find scope within the pay code to give the miners that vital bit extra pay as a reward for the unsocial hours worked in the pits. It was not to be. When the white paper on stage three was eventually published, it offered extra payments for unsocial hours for all industry. The miners were not made a special enough case for their liking. Had Ted Heath ignored or failed to grasp the full meaning of Joe Gormley's message?
I don't remember precisely, but I would think it quite likely that the Prime Minister would have responded positively to Joe Gormley's remarks about his ideas of productivity and indicated, yes, there was that seemed a way of doing something. And certainly the thought of what has come to be called unsocial hours was in our minds as something that, again, where we could open up a bit of a window. So I think it is quite possible that these things were said, but they were not said in the context of a deal or made hard and fast or quantified in any way at all.
What is interesting is that both of you come away from that meeting feeling that there are various paths down which you can go which would avoid confrontation, and yet already confrontation is looming.
Well, is it looming except by hindsight? I mean, confrontation, failure was there every minute of every day as a possibility. But not, I would think, in any real sense, looming until a bit later.
There is a ritual to the negotiating process, but not this time. The coal board made an offer which was bound to be rejected.
I think one of the things went wrong, and this is something we must learn from those months of difficulty that we went through, was that it moved into the government sphere too soon. I think it's very important in negotiations of this sort that it should be left as long as possible, however important the enterprise, and of course mining is very important, between the negotiating teams, that is the union and the employers. But in this case, it was very quickly taken up to government level, and the NEC of the NUM had an early meeting quite soon after the rejection of our initial offer with the cabinet, or with ministers at any rate, in Downing Street, at which we were not present. And this was succeeded by further meetings between the union and either the Prime Minister or the Secretary of State for Employment or other ministers. And this, I must say, was a thread of confusion as far as we were concerned throughout the whole of that period, because we weren't there. The union tended to tell us their view of what went on. We heard from government departments their view, and we were put in a somewhat difficult position.
I personally think that one of the elements in the failure, the tragedy, was our inability to see, to react to the fundamentally new situation that was brought about by the rise in the price of oil.
I mean, I remember sitting down with various colleagues and doing my figuring as to what the impact of all that could be. And the figures were staggering and sensational. And one felt that perhaps in pressure and forth would transform the situation. You couldn't be certain, it was so sudden. And nobody predicted it.
We would have done better to withdraw that white paper, start again, because the AMR had so altered that it was impossible to tell, really. The paper was still well available. And I think that is what we should have done, but it was enormously difficult. And it would have been very damaging to the prestige of the government at the time. Crowings and howlings would have gone up. And it would, as I say, have been very difficult. Nevertheless, I think it is now. I think that is what should have been done.
But what we would be really doing was saying, well, because we're going to have to pay more for oil, this now we've got to pay more for our coal, which we produce at home, which now means we're going to have to pay more to the miners, but all you rest of society, you've got to be held down even more tightly. And we felt that that was a situation that wasn't truly British and truly in the national interest.
Do you think the miners realised that they'd suddenly got an ace in the hole?
I suspect they did, but I don't think it worried them particularly, because I think they thought they held the aces anyhow.
But the miners were in no mood to be placated or to respond to appeals to their national duty. Their executive had turned down the coal board's offer, and with the normal negotiating process at a standstill, had decided to impose an overtime ban without recourse to a pithead ballot. Within days of the start of the ban, supplies to the power stations were cut by 40%. The reason was simple. The bulk of maintenance work in the pits is done as overtime.
Just the time when we wanted to get more coal used in the power stations because of the shortage of oil, we found ourselves faced with an overtime ban on coal, which meant that we had to try and switch back to oil, knowing perfectly well that the oil reserves were very, very delicate indeed. So it was a time of having to make a lot of decisions, and a time of really very, very critical decision implications for the whole of the British economy.
There was yet another opportunity to be missed. For years, the miners had sought payment for the time they had to spend at the pit. Other waiting to travel to the coalfield, putting away the work. Joe Gormley believes it was political meddling that wrecked this chance of a settlement.
I was appalled because I knew then that it hadn't been raised on the floor of the House of Commons. It wouldn't be possible for the government to say yes to that. They could say yes to us eventually, but they could never have said yes to the opposition. And I was appalled that this should be risen, and I knew then that that was it, you know, that the game was stitched and we wouldn't get any joy out of it.
You tactfully don't mention names. Let me be less tactful. What you're saying is that Harold Wilson blew it.
Well, it's reported he rose it on the floor of the House of Commons, and if that's the case, well, it was Harold Wilson who raised the issue. I don't want to be named too many names. I have enough of names in my mind of people who stepped into the fracas and didn't help. You know, who made statements that didn't help the situation at all.
I don't agree with Joe, and he's entitled to his view. I'm entitled to mine. After all, I think he had been proved wrong in thinking that from the outset they would settle on the sort of deal that he had been discussing with Mr. Heath. What happened was that we kept in fairly close touch with them, intervened as little as possible, until we had one or two very serious debates in the... We took a conciliatory line and tried to help all we could and backed what... In this particular case, he had mentioned this idea to me, and I naturally regarded it as confidential until I heard on the radio a particular weekend a whole scheme put forward in a very rough, not a conciliatory speech, a very rough speech, I think, by Mr. Mcgahey in Scotland. So I felt, well, this is now open. And at a meeting of the trade union group, of, which included the miners, discussing what line we should take, and I tried to steer them in that direction. I also made it public.
But you do not believe that you blew it?
No. Well, no, it had already been announced.
I've never been as frustrated in my life on that exercise. The executive, in the negotiation, I'm saying quite sincerely, were in a spirit to want to settle. They didn't want an all-out strike.
And to this day, you remain confident that you could have negotiated something along those lines?
I'm as confident as I sit here in front of this camera that we could have reached a position of settlement that day on that one issue.
It hadn't been going very long before it was obvious that Joe Gormley, to put it kindly, was going to lead from behind. He virtually said nothing at all himself. He just said he would like to leave it to the lads. And the lads more or less spoke as they felt inclined. In fact, I remember very well one little man in the third row, right at the very back, almost out of the window, sort of putting up his hand and eventually getting a hearing, and saying, "Prime Minister, what I can't understand is this. You have told us that we have no option but to pay to the Arabs the price they're demanding for the oil. Now, as far as I know, the Arabs never helped us in World War I, they never helped us in World War II. But we, the miners, we were in World War I and in World War II, and we flogged our guts out in all of that. And why can't you pay us for coal what you're willing to pay the Arabs for oil?" And although that was put in that way, not put as an economist would put it, it in fact was bang on the economic nose. And the Prime Minister really had no answer to it.
You've said that Joe Gormley was leading from behind. Was it your impression that he was leading at all?
Not really, no. He was virtually letting letting the rabbits see the dogs.
Again, at the end of that meeting, then where did you feel the situation was going?
Well, obviously getting worse. That had not done any good. Yes, the situation was generally darkening.
Oh, I think it was a political move by the government. The introduction of the three-day week, in my opinion, was an attempt by the government to alienate the miners, to isolate the miners, or alienate opinion from the miners, and in fact, in my opinion, it boomeranged on them, because after all, they introduced the three-day week, the miners at that stage were in an overtime ban. And after all, it's a bad day if the miners decide to work their normal week and normal hours, and the country goes in a three-day week. And I think it was a political maneuver on the part of the government that misfired.
You see, the odd thing about the situation, Peter Walker, is that the miners that I've spoken to, or many of them, feel that you were politically motivated, the government, that the three-day week, for instance, was designed not because of the economic or the coal stock necessity, but to split the trade union movement.
No, it's totally untrue. I mean, the decisions were made, and very difficult decisions, because you had no idea how long the problem would exist. You had no idea what type of winter you were going to have. And therefore, there wasn't a calculation you could say, well, you know, this is only going to go on for X weeks, and therefore we could be all right. Or you couldn't say, this is going to be a mild winter as opposed to a fierce winter, or a short winter as opposed to a long winter. And when you've got calculations like that and the whole of the economy is dependent upon it, I think it's quite right that a government decides to take action which will preserve the stocks and keep the maximum production going. I think we succeeded in doing that.
The mood of the party was showing itself pretty strongly in letters and messages coming up from most of the area chairmen and the advice they were getting from their constituency organisations and so on, that if an election was called, that this would have a good deal of support. It wasn't unanimous, the view that there ought to be an election, but I think that most people within the party organisation on the voluntary side are saying if you're going to have to have an election, have it early rather than late.
Was this mood conveyed to Mr. Heath?
Oh, very much so. And I must say that Mr. Heath didn't want an election.
And there was a point where I was advocating that we went to the country, yes. I mean, before we did. I mean, if I had my way, we'd have gone to the country 3 or 4 weeks before we did.
Why?
Because I think the country would have supported the view that we'd taken. I felt that if we won an election, I think we would have won an election by a clear majority, then we would have had a stronger influence on the NUM to realise the country backed us, and the settlement would have been that much quicker.
Lord Armstrong was against an early election.
My main feeling was that it would not alter the situation. I had no particular opinion as to who would win at all. But I couldn't imagine that if the government won, it would make the slightest difference. The argument was that with a fresh mandate, an indication that the people were behind them, they could continue, the miners would be impressed by that, and come to negotiate. Now, if the the victory had been absolutely overwhelming, maybe, but I couldn't see a landslide victory. Len Murray produced this really without any warning, and Tony Barber was a bit taken off balance. He rang the Prime Minister, but could only get account of it all, and I gathered, I wasn't there, that he supposed there was no option but to reject it. The Prime Minister agreed, so he went back and rejected it. And with hindsight, that was a tremendous pity. And in fact, it was really quite remarkable that in spite of that initial rejection, it remained on the table and was the subject of discussion for another few days, another week or so, and in fact was treated very seriously. But it took a long time to get over, in fact, I'm not sure we ever really did get over that initial rejection, which was as much as anything, I think, a misunderstanding or a lack of realization of how serious a suggestion it in fact was.
This was a very genuine offer. This wasn't a ploy, it wasn't a tactic. This was designed to get the nation off the hook that was coming later, that already started.
Could you have made it stick?
Oh, I could have made it stick, absolutely sure. The fact that we got a overwhelming vote in that special conference on the 16th of January made that absolutely copper-bottomed. There was no doubt in our mind, but there was doubt in Mr. Heath's mind, and this was the factor that bugged it all through. Mr. Heath was under a great pressure, I believe. He was very constrained. He was deeply worried, quite obviously. and at one point, I remember one of our people leaned across the table and said to him, "Mr. Heath, is there anything we can do to convince you that this is a genuine offer? Is there anything that you would expect us to do beyond, or that we could do beyond what we've offered to do already?" And Mr. Heath didn't reply. He was silent, for several seconds, I don't know. And then it was Mr. Barber who replied and turned the whole thing away. Now, I believe that in that moment, if Mr. Heath had leaned back across the table and said, "All right, I'll take you on trust," then I believe he'd got the solution right in his hands, and he'd got us right in his hands, because either we would have delivered, either other unions would not have come through, they would have held their hands, in which case he was home and dry, and could show that he was the strong man who could force the unions to behave themselves, or we couldn't have held the unions, in which case they'd have come through, you know, some of them sporadically, and again he'd have been home and dry.
Lord Armstrong has a very different account of that last meeting.
It was established fairly early on that the TUC representatives did not know what the miners' claim was. They did not have it in detail in their minds in the way that the Prime Minister did. They did not know the extent to which it could be said to have been met or not met. They had not followed, as it were, the negotiations. They had not discussed their approach with the miners' representatives. They simply took it that their colleagues, Joe Gormley and Lawrence Daly, would do a deal with the government, and that whatever that was, then they were making their offer. Well, when the Prime Minister began to probe this and say, look, all right, you don't know the claim, I will tell you. And I will tell you that it is so many pounds a week for everybody in the industry, not just face workers, but all the surface workers, not just the manual workers on the surface, but the clerks. Say that that will not be quoted, that the TNG won't quote their drivers against the lorry drivers of the coal board. You could see Jack Jones visibly blenching. What about the electricians? Frank Trappell isn't here, but is he going to sit down and see NCB electricians away with more than his chaps, or his chaps going to accept it, even if he tries to hold them back? About all these clerical people? David Bassnett, is that okay by you? It was absolutely okay. It wasn't okay by any of them. But they said, oh, but you'll be able to get over that. That's the kind of thing you deal with in negotiation. And the Prime Minister said, normal negotiation may be, but I assure you, not in this one. There has not been the slightest shift off any of this. But I'm sure it seems to us that Gormley's in a negotiating mood. You think so? You've talked to him about it? Well, no. Don't you ever talk to him about it? Well, we tried once, but it's not an easy thing to get anywhere. But they're members of the General Council. Don't they speak up at these meetings? They don't usually say anything. Come.
Yet, as we look back on that long winter, support for Mr. Heath comes from a likely quarter.
I think that that was an opening that the government could have taken. Whether it would have been able to make it stick, life would have to determine that, because many other sections of workers at that stage were also, in terms of the wages battle, determined to get increases. And once you start making a special case, and for the, I don't know many unions that would stand back and allow and say, well, just one section and none others. I don't think they could have made it stick.
So Mr. Heath was not unwise in being suspicious of it?
I was suspicious of it myself, and I don't blame him for being suspicious of making it stick.
The response to the strike call was total. The winding wheels at the pit heads just came to a stop, but the miners responded to Mr. Wilson's plea not to mass picket the power stations. He wanted no repetition of the scenes of 72 to mar Labour's election campaign. The government referred the miners' claim to the pay board. To Mr. Heath, there seemed no logical reason why they should not now return to work.
If you are putting yourself forward as the government which has got to face the major issue of any government, which is who rules in a democratic nation, then you must be seen all the time to be on top. And it was all right for the first week, but you could begin to see the change when two things happened. One was when the issue ceased to be just the question of how a government ruled. It became a lot of other things as well. Once we were moved off that central issue, then the central issue itself began to pale, and people began to be able to get off the hook. Well, you kept them on that issue, they had to make up their mind. Once you moved off it, they could ignore it. And the second thing that happened, of course, was that a number of unfortunate accidents, which happened very often in election campaigns, came together and gave the impression that we were not in control of events. Very serious matter, that. And that second one, in my view, was the most important of the two. I personally believe the pay board report was very, very important indeed. But it was important not because of its direct effect, it was because it was one in a series of things which gave people the impression that we were not that events were taking hold of us rather than we controlling events.
I believe had he gone 3 weeks earlier, he would have done better in the election. He might have had the edge. He wouldn't have had a landslide, as we now know. We only beat him by 5 seats in a parliament of 620 or thereabouts. Therefore, well, he might have lost by 5 seats, but he would have done better, yes.
And the interesting thing about that result, which, I mean, as you know, the Labour Party played on get back to work with Labour, was really the people felt rather ashamed in that election. They didn't actually vote Labour. I mean, the Labour Party had its smallest vote for years. But they didn't vote for us. They abstained or they voted Liberal. And they ducked the question. They didn't like that rather nasty, tough question that do you want to be governed by Parliament or by the executive of one union with the economic power at the moment? And it was an uncomfortable question to answer. And they didn't answer it.
The miners were given what they wanted and went back to work. In October 74, Harold Wilson won another election. Ted Heath was finished as Tory leader. By mid-75, inflation had soared to 27%. In July of that year, the Labour Party introduced its own voluntary pay policy. The miners accepted the first two stages, but again threatened rebellion against stage three. Sweetened by productivity deals and chastened by the failure of the farmers' strike, the miners settled within the 10% guideline. The lessons of Heath's fall had been well learned by Labour government, but by how far did he fail?
The astonishing thing in many ways is that we got as far as we did and as near as we did. I don't think that excuses anybody who put their foot wrong at different times or takes away from the tragedy of it, but it's nevertheless an element in it. Perhaps enhances the tragedy, if you like.